On a bleak February day in 2024, Astral, the makers of the widely popular rough linter package for Python, dropped a bomb on us. UV, a packaging tool, easy to install, written in Rust, that is supposed to solve all our packaging problems that Python is more famous for than its significant white space. Could this be true? Have they solved all our problems? And is UV the future of Python packaging? The answers are, we will see, absolutely not, and maybe. The truth is, just like Python packaging, complicated. Hello Internet, I'm Hinek, a software engineer and prolific open source maintainer. As someone who lived through the evolution of Python packaging over the past 15 odd years, I have a lot of earned opinions on that topic, both from the perspective of someone having dozens of Python applications running in production as I'm speaking, and the perspective of someone maintaining several high-profile Python packages on PyPI. So let's look what UV brings to the table. And if we're honest, not much. UV solves exactly zero problems of Python packaging that isn't solved by another tool right now. So why is everybody so excited? And why doesn't the video end right here? I have stressed the right now on purpose. They do have grand plans, but they've started with a very narrow scope, which is just good software engineering because, as Gall's law teaches us, a complex system that works is invariably found to have evolved from a simple system that worked. And the complexity they chose to solve is already much bigger than most people would think. I mean, they ended up with more than 200 open issues within not even 48 hours after going public. But to talk about all of this, we need to do it in the context of what's wrong with Python packaging. And there's a lot of vitriol out there, and a hit piece on Python packaging gets always applause. But if you look at the replies and reactions, you realize that not everyone is talking about the same thing. And Python packaging sucks is such an old adage that everybody thinks that everybody is on the same page, but it's just not the case. The only reason why people still maintain the same war cry with the same verve as in 2010 is, warning, hot take, the result of continuous goalpost moving over the past years, and the envy towards much younger ecosystems which seem to have it all figured out. But at the time when the notion of Python packaging being bad went mainstream, it was actually difficult to install packages from PyPI. For one, because PyPI used to be super flaky. It operated for many years like a pile of hacks on something that was never intended to run at such a scale. The biggest reliability problems were papered over by introducing the Fastly CDN, who are sponsoring the traffic to this day. If they wouldn't, bill would be several millions of dollars per month. So thank you, Fastly. But adding features or fixing bugs in the old PyPI codebase was always a case of rolling some dice and hoping the best, which meant that not a lot of got changed. This changed radically when the big rewrite in 2018 went live, and PyPI has been largely a non-problem ever since. But installation was also janky because we had no wheels. While we had a similar concept called eggs, most packages got installed using what's nowadays called a source distribution, or sdist. And since this was many years before declarative package configuration like setup.config or pyproject.toml, this meant arbitrary code execution of the setup.py module on every single installation. And that's not only a security nightmare, it's also very, very slow. To make things more complicated, we also had several people actively feuding over packaging, which makes the current packaging dramas look more like puppies fighting for a dirty sock. If the words distutils 2, and the 2 is important, or easy install, don't ring a bell, be grateful. I viscerally remember being at PyCon US 2014 and feeling the relief when hearing that setup tools is being handed over to the community under the strict condition that certain people won't be allowed to contribute to it. Now, 10 years later, this is largely a solved problem. A properly packaged Python package is easily installable using pip, even if it's full of Fortran and CUDA code. And since we've got official standards around this, there's also other installers than pip, topically UV. What UV brings to the table is speed, speed, speed. Not only is it written in Rust, which, as every piece of Rust software doesn't fail to point out, is blazingly fast, it also does some very smart and aggressive caching, so installation feels instant. Innocuous as it sounds, resolving dependencies based on requirements is where the rubber meets the road. While testing UV on my own open source projects, I've managed to break the resolver immediately. Twice. The second one even got me the great write-up badge, despite originally misinterpreting the bug completely. But A for effort. Either way, resolving dependencies is NP hard. There's even a paper about it that you should, under no circumstances, get for free from the evil website called SciHub, Only very bad people do that. Now, NP complete means there's provably no more efficient way to solve it than trying all alternatives or guessing and checking. Which is kind of bad, because you end up with more plausible solutions to a resolution problem than atoms in the universe much faster than you think. And for various reasons, it's especially difficult for an interpreted language like Python with a very broad community that needs binary packages written in C, Fortran, Julia, and Cthulhu knows what else. I mean, look at the maintainers of Poetry and Pip commiserating over this topic. So solving this property is the absolute groundwork for anything else. And since UV is written in Rust, they do have to clean room implement everything on their own. They can't just use any prior work that's all written in Python, but they have to imitate the result of what pip would do. And given the complex problem space, this is a huge challenge. But since they do their own thing, they also can implement features that don't exist elsewhere, like the possibility to ask for the oldest dependencies that are valid for a package using --resolution=lowest. This is super useful for package maintainers because it allows us to check if our packages still work with the oldest dependency specified in its metadata without any extra tooling. But by and large, what you'll notice most is the speed. Another thing you might notice, and that I love, is that UV is virtual environment first. As of me talking to the camera right now, you cannot install packages with UV into the global Python installation. It's made specifically to modify virtual environments from the outside, which means you only install it once per computer. You do not install it into your projects. You have one global command. To be fair, pip could do that for a while too with the --python option, which I use a lot. And you can also set the require virtual env setting, which you all should do right now if you haven't yet. Link to the docs in the description. This prevents pip from accidentally installing packages into your global Python installation, which traditionally has been a very common reason for people ending up with profoundly broken Python installation, which also contributed to the bad reputation that Python packaging does have. But we've had the technology since at least 2007. Virtual environments are Python's way to have a per-project Python installation. If you break it, you delete it and start over. It's Python's version of Node's node_modules. Except it can live anywhere. Which is why we've got a bunch of helpers to manage them, like direnv that will keep it within your project, or virtualenv wrapper and virtualfish which keep them in one place on your hard disk. Or like pipx for installing and running Python applications without dealing with virtual environments at all. For some, this is great flexibility. For newbies, this can be great confusion. Since Python 3.4, you don't even need an external package. You just run Python 3.12-mvenv.venv and you've got a virtual environment for the Python version that ran it, in this case 3.12. I personally still use the virtualenv command whenever I can because it's much faster than the built-in version. But you know what's even faster? UV's venv subcommand. For me personally, 0.3 versus 0.01 seconds doesn't make a difference, but it's much faster and it adds up when you run it many times, for example, in talks or knocks. Another thing I like about UV is that by default, it assumes that the virtual environment is a directory called .venv in the current directory, which is kind of an emerging best practice. And to offset most of the in-project problems, it marks it as a cache directory using the cutting-edge standard from 2004 and adding a cache0 tag file, thanks to some fool asking on GitHub for it. This should exclude it from backup software that supports this standard, which unfortunately is not all of them. But chicken-egg problem and you gotta start somewhere, right? So again, the same song. Nothing new, UV made existing tools much faster and added an, in my opinion, very good opinion, but nothing else is new under the sun. Which brings us to the biggest current criticism of Python packaging. People have used npm and cargo and they do want that in Python. Or they haven't used them, but they couldn't care less about packaging technology. They are just busy curing cancer or stopping climate change, which is fair. For a mainstream language like Python, with many new users coming in every single day, it is fair that users don't want to have to know how to structure their applications or what a virtual environment is before writing their first line of code. We've had low-level solutions to these problems for a very long time. Tools like VirtualEnv Wrapper from 2008 or VirtualFish from 2015, which both help you to manage virtual environments, or pip tools since 2012 to create recursive log files that guarantee reproducible builds with some asterisks. But using these tools requires a deep understanding of the concepts, and they come with sharp edges. For example, pip tools can't create cross-platform log files, which are log files that can be used to install an application both on macOS running on ARM and Linux running on PowerPC, or any other tuple of operating systems and hardware. It only creates log files that are valid for the architecture, operating system, and Python version that pip tools itself is running on. Although I developed for macOS for Linux, that was almost never a problem. The operating systems were close enough for my kind of dependencies, and I've used pip tools for almost a decade. But that changed when I got an ARM Mac. Suddenly, it was a big problem. And the canonical solution here is to use Docker containers to create the deployment log files, which I'm gonna just say is not very mainstream. Then we've got high-level projects that aim to hide all the complexity behind a single friendly command, like PDM or Poetry, or somewhat newly, RAI. Since there is no official standard for cross-platform log files in Python, although the pep process for one has just started, so good luck, Brett, PDM and Poetry have both invented their own formats. And of course, they're different. RAI is interesting insofar that it's just wrapping what's already there, like using pip tools for recursive pinning. And more importantly, it has been taken over by UV's makers Astral, with the goal of growing UV into a fully-fledged replacement. Unsurprisingly, that's also where UV comes into play, because it implemented the pip tools compile and sync commands that create a log file and synchronize a virtual environment to the dependencies in a log file, respectively. Of course, what this means is that UV does not support cross-platform log files. Remember how I mentioned that resolving dependencies is a very hard problem? Now imagine resolving them for multiple targets. You just keep adding dimensions to a very complex problem. And of course, as you would expect, UV is incredibly fast at doing what pip tools have been doing for us before. And it has the upside that one UV can create log files for any Python version. So only one UV per computer and you're done. Which leaves us with a final problem space, building packages into wheels and source distributions that others can install using pip or UV. As someone who maintains many pure Python packages and one with a C dependency, I'm gonna say pure Python packages are easy. There's a step-by-step tutorial on packagingpython.org, I will link it in the description. We've got several build backends with different feature sets that broadly conform to the same standards. This is a solved problem. On the other hand, packages with compile dependencies are an absolute nightmare. It would go too far to open this particular can of worms too, but at least with CI build wheel, the situation got a lot better than it used to be a few years ago. You just have to copy-paste some CI YAML soup and bring a lot of patience. All in all, there's a lot of space for growth here, but I suspect this is not gonna be a hyper focus for UV, since this only affects very, very few people. Which leads us to the question, where does all that leave us? Astral is off to a great start. They have re-implemented limited but faster versions of pip, virtualenv, and pip tools. It's wonderful to see multiple people work full-time on Python packaging. This is absolutely unprecedented. They've got great talent on board, including the author of RipGrep, my favorite grep alternative, and a very high velocity. It seems like Charlie and friends never sleep. But so far, for my day-to-day work, UV does not make much of a difference. The things it's fasted, I just don't do that often. And I do need cross-platform log files, so I'm sticking with PDM, which works great for us. And it might work actually better in the future if PDM starts using UV internally, because why not? Because the ecosystem started moving immediately. Bernard Gabor, one of the Tox maintainers, has released the Tox UV plugin almost on day one of UV's release. And Nox has also merged support for UV within weeks. And in tools like Tox and Nox that allow you to define different environments based on different Python versions and different dependency versions and so on, those performance improvements really add up. Let's look at my struct log, which uses Tox. By the way, isn't the logo awesome? It's made by my bestie Lynn Root, and I'm happy whenever I look at it. So back to Tox. It creates a directory called .tox where it puts all the virtual environments necessary to run your tests or whatever you tell it to run. Struct log requires a total of 20 for a full run. Tox is smart enough to not recreate them unless necessary, so the first run usually takes much longer than the subsequent ones. When using pip, On my notebook, it takes 131 seconds for the first run and 22 seconds for the second one. Now, if all you do is to install Tox-UV along with Tox, the time goes down to 85 seconds on the first run, which is about 35% faster, and 18 seconds on the second one, which is about 20% faster. Those are not life-changing numbers, but they do add up over the day and over the lifetime of a project. If you're interested in more ways to turbocharge Tox, I've written a blog post a while ago about that, and I will link it in the description. Now, all these improvements also translate into CI performance. While you usually don't create many virtual environments per CI worker, and caching is still a little bit terra incognita for UV, it still makes a palpable difference, again, just by installing Tox-UV in addition to Tox. So Structlock's CI went from 139 seconds to 101 seconds. Again, this is not life-changing, but it's a third of the time and it compounds over time. I've also tried switching my GitHub action called build and inspect Python package that does exactly what the name says to UV. And it shaved 13 seconds of the action runtime. That's 40%. So this is an action that many projects run on every CI build. Therefore, mixing this with the gains from Tox-UV, you get a significant impact of how much time we spend waiting for CI. And open source maintainers spend a lot of time waiting for CI. You may be wondering, what about capitalism? And I understand your concern, but capitalism wins too, because faster CI means paying less for CI. CI providers that build by time hate this weird little trick. And this is why I'm excited, even short term, about UV. I don't know how long it'll take them to fulfill their grand vision of being the cargo for Python. And given the problem space, I wouldn't hold my breath, despite the unquestionable in-house talent they have. But right now, it can improve the life of many, many open source maintainers and lower the CI bill for even more companies. So do definitely check it out. Don't expect magic. Do expect rough edges. But be creative about where the performance improvements could help you. And that's all I have for you today. I hope you enjoyed a bit of a different video, because I don't want to pigeonhole myself too much into complex software engineering videos that take 2 months to make. And try different things too, especially if I feel that I have a valuable opinion to share. I've also challenged myself to produce this video as fast as possible. I mean, look at me, I didn't even have time to shave. So I hope it wasn't 2 months again. And I hope it's short. I'm still blown away by the positivity I'm experiencing. While YouTube is not very gracious with sending relevant traffic my way, I'm clearly still in the honeymoon phase where my commenters talk to me instead about me. So please keep it coming. Let me know what you think and see you hopefully soon.